I've got a very good topic this week, righteousness versus good behavior. More and more, I see the need to clarify such topics, as I've had many people come to me completely confused about the subject matter. So I really pray that this lesson is going to be a help to many. Let's look at the screen or open our Bibles to Revelation chapter 19, verse 8. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. When a saved person passes away in this life and goes to the judgment seat of Christ and enters ultimately into the kingdom of heaven, they are arrayed in white fine linen. And what caused that fine linen to be clean and white? That symbolizes righteousness, as the Word of God tells us. But what is righteousness? Some people don't really understand it completely. In God's Word, it says, "For the fine linen is the righteousness of saints." The Roman Catholic NAB Bible, the New American Bible of the Roman Catholic Church, says she was allowed to wear a bright, clean linen garment. The linen represents the righteous deeds of the holy ones. This seems to be the root cause of confusion. Do you have righteousness? Does your robe symbolize righteousness or righteous deeds that you did? Well, almost all modern Bibles say righteous acts or righteous deeds or good things that are done by people. That's what they say that their God says washes a person's robe. The ability for a fleshly person to do righteousness in the flesh, good deeds, righteous acts, good things to please God. That's exactly what they're telling people. And this is a fulfillment of Job 41, verse 19, where Antichrist floods the world with many different Bibles and causes confusion, and the whole world is drunk on ultimately the wine of Babylon. As an example, just to clarify it, we've got an Amplified Bible that is out in the markets. It's been out since the mid-1960s, right after Vatican II concluded, and it is Vatican-influenced. It lines up with the Vatican text. There's a pattern to it. It says in Revelation chapter 19, verse 8, in the Amplified Bible, "She has been permitted to dress in fine, radiant linen, dazzling and white, for the fine linen is," which they're telling you, signifies or represents the righteousness, in other words, the upright, just, and godly living, deeds and conduct, and right standing with God of the saints, God's holy people. As a former Roman Catholic, I can tell you that this is the doctrine that I was taught in the Catholic Church, that you go to confession once a week or whenever you need to confess your sins to a priest because you've been a bad person. You have not been able to perform up to God's standards in your fleshly body. You either told a lie, you lusted after the opposite sex, perhaps the same sex. It doesn't really matter because a person in the flesh is working iniquity no matter what they do. But this has been, in my opinion, the root cause of the confusion today. Now, if we go back in time to 1649, before the Douay-Rheims Channeler version came out around 1750, the Catechism of Rome said, "What is the presumption of God's mercy?" And the answer is a foolish confidence of salvation without leading a good life or any care to keep the commandments, such as they entertain who think they will be saved by faith only without good works. It sounds good to someone that isn't familiar with the Word of God in terms of the total canon of Scripture, but it is really misleading people, because if you're not born again off of incorruptible seed, you're in the flesh and you can't do anything to please God anyway. So if you're born again, you have complete confidence in salvation that you can do no good. And I'll get into that further in the discussion today. So what did Jesus Christ say? In Matthew chapter 19, it says, "And behold, one came and said unto him, Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? And he said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments." Was Jesus talking about the fleshly commandments? Or was he giving the body of born-again believers counsel that we are to believe on him, his word is true, and be born again of the Holy Spirit as the only way to keep the commandments of God? It says in 1 John chapter 3, "And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abideth in us by the Spirit which he hath given us." So if you've received the Holy Spirit, you keep God's commandments in a spiritual sense, because your flesh is never going to be justified by the law, and it will not inherit the kingdom of heaven, your flesh, because corruption doesn't inherit incorruption. And part of being a real Christian is understanding that there is a war going on here. Believing God and receiving the Holy Spirit by being born again, that is what righteousness is. It says in John chapter 8, "I said therefore unto you, that ye shall die in your sins, for if ye believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins." 1 John chapter 3, "Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin, because he is born of God." God is not speaking to people saying, "Well, you suddenly profess a belief in Jesus Christ, and now I will sanctify your flesh, and you're going to be nice people without any sin in your fleshly behavior, and you're never going to lust after the opposite sex, you're never going to tell a lie ever again, you're never going to commit anything that transgresses the law of Moses." And that's not anything that Jesus Christ ever said. In Romans chapter 4, "But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness." Faith. "Even as David also describeth the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works." In 1 John chapter 2 it says, "If ye know that he is righteous, ye know that every one which doeth righteousness is born of him." The only way to do righteousness is to be born again of the Spirit, and the only way to be born again of the Spirit is to believe on Jesus Christ, the incorruptible Word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. And God tries that belief. People can profess a belief all day long and never get saved. God evaluates whether they're a true believer or not. What the Holy Ghost taught me is we are washed by the blood of the Lamb and our faith in Jesus Christ. We are not washed by our own deeds. It says in Titus chapter 3, "Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost," being born again, because you finally admit to God that you can't do anything without Jesus Christ, that you're dead in your sins, you're on your way to hell, and you have 0% to offer God. You have to surrender to Jesus Christ and ask him to save you from the hell that you deserve, and I had to do the same thing before I got saved. In Revelation chapter 12 it says, "And they overcame him," meaning the body of true believers, the few that inherit eternal life, "by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death." You can love God. We do love God. We love our families. And what God is saying, we don't love our lives unto the death, because there is a war going on. And that war is the flesh versus the spirit. In Isaiah 64, But we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags, and we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, have taken us away. God makes it very clear, we bring nothing to the table. If we trust in our own righteousness, we're going to go straight to hell because we've already been judged. That's where we're going by default. Jesus didn't came to judge the world. He didn't come into this world to judge it. It was condemned already. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. This is something that every Christian needs to have a solid understanding of. That in your natural body, you're not saved. You're not justified. No flesh is justified by the law. But in a spiritual body, if you're one of the few that have been born of the Spirit because of true belief and true faith in the true Jesus Christ and not the many worldly false Christs that are out in the markets, then you're saved and justified in a spiritual body that God acknowledges when you're born of the Spirit. It says in Galatians chapter 5, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law." Does anybody believe Galatians chapter 5? A true Christian realizes there is a war, the flesh against the Spirit. You want to do things that are right in your walk as a daily Christian. You don't want to lie, cheat, steal, murder, commit adultery, fornicate, etc. But every one of us is unjustified in the flesh. And how God looks at that is different than what we may look at. Is God more offended by someone that is a fornicator, that is living in an adulterous situation without being married? Is he offended by someone that sings silly hymns that are not biblical, like Lily of the Valley? Is he offended by someone that just uses a lexicon to interpret scripture, which leads him straight back to the Babylonian understandings? Is he offended by someone who gets into a fight or gets drunk? Well, all these things, if they're fleshly, you've transgressed the law by committing any one of these acts. So a person is guilty of everything if they haven't been born of the Spirit. Once you're born of the Spirit, you're very aware that you cannot perform that which you would. And that makes us Christians. We don't have big egos. We don't trust or put confidence in the flesh. Righteousness, good behavior, or other. We've got a professing Christian community. And of that professing Christian community, those that say, I'm a Christian, we have few that are truly righteous because they receive the Holy Ghost. Their works are directed by the witnesses of 1 John chapter 5. Verse 7 specifically. If they don't do works in accordance with that, they're going to suffer loss at the judgment seat of Christ. Under the law of faith, an incorruptible seed, the word of God, which is Jesus Christ our Lord. That's what true Christians are under. The unrighteous, which are many in the professing Christian community, they're not saved. They trust in their righteous acts, their Bibles, their lamps, coming out of the mouth of Leviathan, who is a king over all the children of pride. The children of pride are the many unsaved people that profess to be Christians, because only few are truly saved. Their Bibles typically say righteous acts. They trust in themselves. Their works, whether they're exhibiting good behavior, even much better than the real Christians, like working in soup kitchens, doing fleshly charities, giving clothing to the poor, it doesn't matter. They can do whatever they want to do to look, by appearances, righteous and good on their best behavior, but they're just works of iniquity, according to Jesus Christ. See Matthew chapter 7, somewhere around verses 20 through 22, if I remember correctly. So the works of flesh, in all they do, because you're not born again of the Spirit. If you're not born again of the Spirit, you can't even begin to walk as a Christian. They're under the law of Moses, so they transgress every day of their lives, racking up more and more punishment at the great white throne judgment, which will ultimately end in being cast into the lake of fire for eternity. Everyone else in the world, you know, atheists, agnostics, Buddhists, it doesn't matter. They're all unsaved. They all do works of iniquity. They all do works of the flesh and all they do. They're under the law of Moses, and they have the same fate. I'm going to talk about the world's perfect Christian example. This is what I was taught long ago. Let's go back to the 1970s and 1980s. Mother Teresa of the Catholic Church was in the media often. She spent a lot of time in India, if I remember correctly, most of it in Calcutta. And she helped the poor and by appearances was a perfect worldly example of what a Christian would be. Number one, she was Catholic, and number two, I'm not so sure she believed everything that the Catholic hierarchy outlined as the official believings of the Catholic Church, or the official beliefs of the Catholic Church. But she was quoted saying, if you judge people, you have no time to love them. And that is a good quote that kind of gives me a little bit of a synopsis of my upbringing. Certainly Roman Catholics, for the most part, are nice, good, solid, intelligent people. The ones that I know and have met are nice people. They're just not saved. But I pray for them. But this is an example. Why did the lady called Mother Teresa, because as far as I know, she was a mother to no one, why did she think this? In John chapter 12, it says, and if any man hear my words and believe not, I judge him not. For I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. Jesus Christ didn't come to judge. But the words that he spoke that are living will judge everyone in the last day. The world's already condemned. Jesus came so that the world could be saved by believing on him, but only few find salvation. So the world is condemned. You're on your way to hell. You're a child of the devil. If you're not born again of the Spirit. It says in the Catholic Bible, so be imitators of God. Be like the Most High. That's what the God of the world wants to be. If you go to Isaiah chapter 14, somewhere around verse 14, it says, I will be like the Most High. That's Lucifer, the God of the world. The God of Babylon, the King of Babylon. Okay? Be like the Most High. So in other words, don't judge people because you have to love them. Well, what does God say? If you look over on the right side of the screen, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, do ye not know that the saints shall judge the world? So saved people judge the world. Well, how is that? And if the world shall be judged by you, are ye unworthy to judge the smallest matters? It says down in John chapter 7, judge not according to the appearance, but judge righteous judgment. God commands the saints to judge. And the world kicks back Matthew chapter 7 in retaliation, and unfortunately many professing believers really don't understand it because they're believing on a corrupted scripture to begin with. But the saints judge the world. And that judgment is a righteous judgment. And we judge by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. So I tell people, you're on your way to hell. You're a child of the devil unless you're born again of the Spirit. So I do judge people, and I point them to the metric. The basis for my judgment is not mine, but rather the words of the Most High God that the Holy Ghost gave the prophets to record, and Jesus Christ is the Word made flesh. And the Word says the world has been judged and condemned to an eternity in the lake of fire already, and few believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and are born again of the Spirit so that they're no longer part of the world that's going to be condemned, but they're born out of the world and they have spiritual bodies which are justified. And I judge everything by the word of God. I don't judge Leviathan to be a crocodile or a dinosaur. I judge it because Leviathan is the Antichrist, as the Most High has spoken in His Word through the prophets, taught to me by the Holy Spirit. And that's the answer that every Christian should be giving. You have to trust the Holy Spirit to teach you spiritual things and not follow worldly things. So in conclusion, we have no righteousness except placing our faith in Jesus Christ and our true belief in the incorruptible Word of God. Not corruptible, but incorruptible. If we have true faith, our faith will be evident to God by our works of faith when God tries the believer. So all these people that say, well, I receive you, Jesus, well, that's great. You become a Christian when God receives you. It works both ways. And He tries the faith of people, and He determines whether someone is a true believer. The world, Babylon, interprets corrupted scripture literally, not pure seed spiritually. Therefore, they're confounded. If you want the world's wisdom, go to the lexicon, go to the Bible apologetics, turn on the television, listen to the radio, listen to someone that's not a true believer in the pure Word of God, and that's what you're going to get. And it's all traceable to what it says in Job chapter 40, somewhere around verse 19, I can't remember exactly, that the chief of the ways of God, the head of Christian apologetics that is apart from the truth, is Behemoth. And I have spoken at length about this. He is the chief of the ways of God. You don't want to listen to Jesus Christ. You don't want to believe in the Word of God. You don't want to trust in salvation by faith alone and receiving the Holy Spirit. Then Behemoth, the king of Babylon, is going to step in and teach you all you want to know about the Most High and mislead you along the way, but you'll probably love every moment of it because it's a never-ending, ear-tickling Christian entertainment extravaganza, is the way I will put it. Much learning, never coming to any knowledge of the truth. That's all I have to say for this week. I will look forward to a different topic next week, but I really feel that this subject matter is important at this time, because of the confusion that I see and probably everyone listening sees on a regular basis about what is righteousness or what is good behavior and how do we wash our robes. God bless everyone. Thank you for listening, and I will put a different subject up next week.